Practice of meditation is like the functioning of an organism. For this purpose, it is necessary for us to know what an organism is and how it operates. Briefly, it may be said that an organism is a living entity. It is a total individuality in itself. It has its own parts which make up itself as a whole. The relationship between a part and the whole to which it belongs is something worth noticing. In our earlier session some time back, we have evidently made reference to two kinds of relation between a part and the whole. One kind of relation is called mechanism. The other kind of relation is called organism. Mechanical relation differs from the organismic relation of the parts of a living body. Heaps of bricks or boulders on the roadside look like a whole because they constitute a body of several elements which are its components. In this heap of bricks or stones we see on the roadside, one stone may be touching another stone, one brick touches another brick, so there is a connection of a part to the whole, which is the heap mentioned. The speciality of this mechanistic relation is that you can remove one part from that whole without affecting the other parts. If 10 boulders are removed from the heap of boulders, the other boulders will not be even be aware that something has gone. They will still stand perfectly in order. This is a peculiarity of mechanistic relation. There are machines of various types in industrial organizations. Every machine is made up of many parts, nut and bolt and what not. If one part of the machine is taken away or the machine is dismantled, you cannot say that the machine is dead, because you can reassemble the parts and make the machine once again a whole and it will operate perfectly well. But take the instance of a human body. This also is a whole made up of several parts. Limbs, cells, little elements go to form this body which is human. Now, if we apply this logic of the mechanistic relation of the part to the whole and sever a part of the human body, the other parts of the body will certainly know that something has been lost. There will be injury caused to the whole organism if a limb is severed, but no injury will be caused to the heap of bricks if some of the bricks are removed from the whole. This illustration is to be born in mind for the purpose of knowing what happens actually while we engage ourselves in meditation. If we imagine that meditation is thinking something, among many other things which are also capable of being thought of, we are applying the logic of mechanism and not organism in meditation. Because you may think one thing in meditation, or you may not think that, you may think another thing tomorrow according to your wish. One thought does not seem to be organically connected with another thought. This is what we wrongly imagine. Our mental makeup and our physical constitution, neither of these is a mechanism in the sense we have defined it. The body is a living whole, and a part of it cannot be removed without affecting the whole. I mentioned by saying that meditation is something like the functioning of an organism. How does the organism operate? You can observe the function of your own body. The operation of any single part of the body is determined also at the same time by the operation of all other parts of the body also. There is no isolated functioning of any limb of the body in a human individual. If anything happens to the body anywhere, it happens to the whole body. A sneeze from the nose is an illness of the whole organism. It is not a malady of the nose only. If there is a headache, it is not the head that is in agony, the entire body is sick. If there is a stomachache, any kind of pain in the body whatsoever will indicate the whole organism is in a state of disbalance. The parts of the organism are not set in order. Every part of our body is as important as any other part of the body is something well known to us. We cannot have a special affection for some part and a dislike for some other part, because they all collaborate in a fraternity to carry on this total function called the living of the organism, the health of the organism, the happiness of the organism, the peace of the organism, the complete satisfaction that is characteristic of a healthy individual. Meditation is to be compared to an organismic process. You have to give up the notion that in meditation you are thinking something outside the mind. When a limb of the body operates, it is not that something outside the body is functioning. When the legs move, they are not moving, being outside the body. The entire body is moving when the legs move. When the hand lifts an object, the whole body lifts the object. When we consider the operation of our mind along these lines, we will realize that every thought is somehow or other connected to every other thought. Otherwise, we cannot know that these varieties of thoughts are our thoughts. If each thought is disconnected from every other thought, who will know that they are somebody's thoughts? There is a uniting, cohesive principle behind the functioning of even a multifaceted functioning of the mind. I thought yesterday something, today I have thought 100 things. Though you have thought 100 things, you know that you have thought those 100 things. And you have brought those 100 things into a single total of comprehensive psychological operation. Spiritual success, which is mostly through the practice of right meditation, is determined by the manner in which we organically connect the parts of the mind in its practice of concentration on the ideal. Most of the difficulties of spiritual seekers consist in the wandering of the mind, as they call it, the movement of the mind away from the ideal chosen to other things in the world, towards which the mind moves for certain important reasons. What is the reason? It is a total ignorance on the part of oneself as to the relationship of the thought process and the object of thought. Another important aspect that we have to bear in mind in this connection is that the object so-called of meditation is not something in front of you, just as a thought is not something in front of the mind. The mind cannot think a thought as standing outside itself. The relationship of the mind to the ideal, we call sometimes as the object of meditation, is vital, living, organic, not mechanical. Therefore, that chosen ideal, we call the object of meditation, cannot stand outside the operation of the mind. If the linkage of the object of meditation is organically related to the mind in a living process of comprehension, the mind cannot wander in the direction of some other thing without disconnecting itself totally from the ideal of meditation. This disconnection is unfortunate, because the very purpose of the choice of the ideal called the object of meditation is to decide once and for all in the beginning itself that there is a benefit accruing from the meditational process. If the mind feels that such a benefit is not going to accrue and it has a doubt about the whole process or adventure, it will move in another direction, in the direction of something which it would feel is going to promise its real satisfaction. The contradiction is very obvious. How would you choose an object of meditation as the beloved and the most worthwhile of things for your ultimate satisfaction, and then divorce yourself from that ideal immediately after a few minutes by engaging the attention on something other than that on which you have bestowed so much faith at the beginning itself as the ideal of fulfillment? There is a psychological contradiction involved in this agonizing activity which is a dual process in which the mind on one hand decides to engage itself wholly by attention on what it has chosen as the objects of its fulfillment, and at the same time disconnects itself from the chosen ideal and goes to something which it has abandoned earlier as not worthwhile. This happens because the organic connection of thoughts and the relation to objects is not known properly. Most of the spiritual seekers are very bad psychologists. They don't understand how the mind works at all. The mind works in terms of things and objects, no doubt, but it does not think or operate upon the objects in a mechanical manner so that you can withdraw yourself from it at any time, just as you can take away some stones from the heap of bricks. Everything is connected to everything else is something we have noticed in our earlier observations during the previous sessions. The world clings to us in some way or other, positively or negatively, because of the organic relation it has with our own selves. And we cling to every part of the body because of the organic relation that there is between the parts and the bodily individuality. Whenever there is a clinging to something or a desire to abandon something, this positive and negative prehensive process, as they are calling it, takes place. And even when you dislike a thing, you are establishing your connection with that thing in a negative manner. Because it does not mean if you are rightly capable of appreciating what is happening to your mind, it is not true that the mind is connected to the object only in affection, and it is not so in dislike. It is one and the same thing for the mind, whether you like a thing or dislike a thing, because there is attraction on one side and repulsion from another side, but both these processes are happening, taking place in the mind itself. So it is a concussion, a kind of push and a blow that is dealt upon the mind, whether it is in a state of affection or dislike. Thus, organic thinking, to which I made reference in the beginning, cannot involve the process of liking and disliking, because likes and dislikes are mechanical activities of the mind, and we are not mechanisms, is what I have already mentioned to you. So neither can you love a thing nor hate a thing if you are a real spiritual seeker. Because in that wrong process of liking and disliking, choosing and eliminating, you have become a mechanism, like a printing machine or a bulldozer or a railway train, but you have ceased to be an individual of a human type. Then no satisfaction can follow by any activity that you engage yourself in. The whole world will look wretched, life will look miserable, because you will get nothing out of anything that you do, because in every action this blunder is committed, namely the isolation of the part from the whole in a mechanical manner, forgetting the fact that your body is an organic and mind also is an organic completeness. And the total individuality, which is psychophysical, is also organically related to the whole world outside. So there is no escaping from anything in the world. This is why Bhagavan Sri Krishna reiterates in the Bhagavad Gita, you cannot keep quiet. There is no such thing as keeping quiet. No part of the body keeps quiet. It operates, it works. A good physiologist will know how Every part of the body is active always. Why does it not keep quiet sometimes? Because it is an organism. It cannot keep quiet like a stone on the roadside. This organismic relation among the parts of the body as well as the processes of the mind in their connection or relationship with the world as a whole is the foundational knowledge that should help us in our onward movement along the direction of meditation. Now, in this context of this little bit of analysis that we have carried on, you can know on what to meditate. You yourself will know where the object of your meditation is. It is like to choosing, finding out where your body is. You ask a question to your own self, where is my body? The answer is very clear to you. But such an answer does not come from you if another question is of a similar nature is raised, where is the world? You will say the world is there, outside. But you do not say that your body is somewhere outside. Why don't you say the body is somewhere there? It is not somewhere. It is not sometime. It is always and everywhere in me. If this type of organic affirmation applicable to one's own body can be applied also to one's relationship to the world outside, you will find the whole world is aglow with the life that throbs together with your own individuality, so called. The world will rise up into action for your own benefit. That is an analogy to show that when you are engaged in the practice of meditation, the whole world is active. It is not some secret action that you are engaged in a corner of your room. Nobody knows that I am meditating. I am calmly sitting in a corner and nobody in the world knows that I am meditating at all. This is a mechanistic view of your thought process. But if you know the organic connection of yourself, your mind and the world as a whole, there is no secrecy anywhere in the world. If walls have ears, the entire space has all eyes to know what is happening where. The benefit in meditation is also the trouble that you may have to face in meditation arises on account of this organic relation that subsists between yourself and the world as a whole. As I mentioned, remember it again and again, you wake up sleeping dogs. As one can say easily, the world is sleeping and is not concerned with what you are doing because you have severed yourself from the world in a wrong notion that you are mechanically connected to it and you can do anything that you like in regard to things in the world. But once you establish a vital connection in your deepest heart of hearts, an organism as the whole world begins to throb in your act of meditation, every tree, every leaf, every brick, every bird in the air will be aware that something is taking place. We have read in the Puranas and the scriptures that gods in heaven become aware that so and so is engaged in meditation. Where are the gods? They are perhaps in high heaven, but there is no such thing as high heaven in an organic completeness of God's creation. When you touch something, you have touched everything. So when you have thought one thing, you have thought everything. When you touch one part of your body, you have touched every part of your body, the sensation is complete. So meditation is such a kind of cosmically oriented total thinking, we may say, though the word thinking is a very inadequate word to describe what actually is taking place at that time. The personality rises in a wholesome manner, in its wholesome relationship with the world of things. Everything begins to vibrate in harmony with you. You have neither friends nor enemies at that time. Because the negativity and the positivity of love and hatred have arisen in the psychology of mental operation due to disconnection of the personality as a part from the operations in the world outside. If you persist in thinking that you are only in some place and the world is somewhere else, and perhaps the object of your meditation in a third place, you will only be wasting your time in sitting for meditation, and nothing will come out of this activity as a fruit thereof. Because the fruit is connected to the total tree. The entire tree it is that biologically yields the fruit of its activity right from the root, the tongue, up to the leaves and the little branches. The growth of a tree is also like the growth of a human body. It is also an organism. Everything is everywhere there. The little fruit that is hanging on the edge of a little branch or a twig is directly connected to the root that is under the earth. So is what is happening within us and so called outside ourselves is related to all things. The concept of our relationship to all things is totally alien to human nature. No human being can think in this manner, because every person is different from every other person. Everything is different from every other thing. You cannot see one thing connected to another thing or one thing really related to another thing. Even a brother is not really related to a brother in the family. They can separate themselves without harming themselves or to their disadvantage. Closest relations in the family can sever themselves as if they were never family members at all. All organizations of people can collapse by separation of the members thereof. Because every kind of connection that we can think of in this world, political, social, industrial, business, whatever it is a mechanistic relation, and therefore it can end one day as it began sometime. But the world process is not going to begin sometime and end sometime. It is a movement from eternity to eternity. God operates through all this creation. And therefore He operates through meditational process also. It is certainly a great advantage for us to go on repeating this idea of an organic connection there, being there between ourselves and all things, and all life is vital life. This is perhaps was in the mind of the great sage who said, Udara charitanamtu vasudhaiva kutumbakam, ayam nijah paro veti ganana laghu chetasam. This is my relation, he is my enemy, he is my brother, he is somebody else. This kind of calculation of relation with other things is poverty stricken thinking, says the Yoga Vasishtha. Udara charitanam tu vasudhaiva kutumbakam. For a large hearted individual, there are no individuals at all. They are like drops merged in the ocean. there should be first of all a conviction and a doubtless affirmation in the mind that the meditational process is going to succeed. It is not a dubious adventure on our part. Let me try, if it comes, if it doesn't come, let me give it up. If this attitude is behind our beginning the process itself, nothing will come. Doubts are our traitors, as the poet said. You have no enemies in the world except your own doubts. They destroy all worthwhile things in your life. If there is a true relation between one thought and another thought in your mind, a true relation between your psychophysical organism and the world of perception, then life assumes the form of a magnificent reality, and it never remains a meaningless pursuit as it sometimes appears to people who are segregated psychologically and socially. Really, things are not so separate as they appear to our senses. There is no paralysis of the organism of the world process. They are vitally connected. As you can summon any limb of your body to work in an instant and it works, so should be your conviction inside that you can summon any god for your purpose if you really want it to be done. It is Yoga Vasita here again that tells us, Lokesha Palayantitam. Such a devoted, honest, sincere seeker does not require any security guards. He is protected by the gods from all the quarters of heaven. Sarva disho bali masmai haranti, says the Upanishad. Every quarter of heaven will come beseeching you, offering you its tributes. The world seems to be rejecting us and making us look like poor nobodies. This has happened because we have rejected the world. The world is behaving with us in the manner in which we are behaving with it. The world is totally outside me, you are saying every day. The world also says, my dear boy, you are totally outside me, I will give you nothing. So if you are poor in mind and body and social connections, don't complain that somebody is the cause, you are the cause. The world is rich and enormously filled with the treasures of a divine character. The world can never become poor. The poverty is in our relationship to things. Meditation is a rectifying process in human life so that we may, by this sincere adventure on our part, endeavor on our part, live here a satisfying life, a comfortable life, a happy life of no perplexity, no anxiety, no sorrow, no expectation of something unknown in the future. Everything becomes a certainty. The world is a certainty. It is not a doubtful existence. And if your relationship to it also is a certainty in the manner described in organic fashion, then the tree of creation, as we have it mentioned in the 15th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, will yield the fruit of immortal bliss. There is no benefit, even in the least, by affirming our egoism too much and defying the existence of somebody else. By doing that, you defy the world itself. If the world is defied, mortality seeps into the vitals of the personality and death takes place. Death is the inability of the bodily organisms to cooperate with the functioning of the physical organism of the cosmos. We die because of our egos only. The ego-ridden physicality, bodily existence is given a death blow by the widely spread physical operations of the five elements, earth, water, fire, air and ether. The five elements do not die. And if the bodily individuality is also made up of the five elements only, we have to explain what actually takes place when we die. There is a dismembered situation arising in the physical components of this body by the severance of the ego from its connection with this earlier formation of the five elements as a physical individuality. Death is therefore the severance of ego from the five elements. When it connects itself to certain parts of the five elements only, it locates itself somewhere and says, I am here. This I am here is the individual speaking, and who is the individual? It is a little shred or a little piece extracted or isolated from the widespread five elements, earth, water, fire, air and ether, and centralized in an affirmation which is called ego consciousness. If this ego, which is only a name that we give to the affirmation of consciousness in one place only, if that can be melted down by its isolation from this location of the body and can be connected to all the widespread nature of the elements, you become cosmically aware and you will not feel the pinch of death at that time. The ego it is that feels the pain, and ego is only a wrongly affirmed center of the all-pervading consciousness. With all these available informations, we have to daily recapitulate whatever we have heard from teachers and guides and masters, from scriptures, from sadhus and sannyasins, and try to digest these ideas and attempt to live these ideas, knowing well that you are going to be more happy than an emperor finally if this benefit can accrue to you. Meditation is not an activity, it is operation of your being itself. It is not a work that you are doing like a laborer, due to which you can get tired and you would not like to do it at all because it is somebody's business. Meditation is not somebody's business, it is my business. And my business is equal to the whole world's business. And therefore, there cannot be a fatigue in meditation. You will be rejoicing inside that every step you take in the direction of this successful art is also a step taken in the direction of more and more fulfillment of your personality, and not a negative reaction set up by anyone, fooldom is the word. We have heard it often mentioned in the Upanishads. Completeness is creation. Completeness is your own way of thinking. Completeness is your relationship to things. And meditation is complete thinking. Hari Om Tat Sat.